Yes.
Fear has no place.
Provision is by the name of Jesus.
Yes.
Whatever you need is available through the name of Jesus. Peace of mind, peace in body and flesh, healing of your body, forgiveness of all sin, no condemnation. There is no condemnation. God is not condemning you. He looks upon us with mercy and grace. In His presence is fullness of joy.
Yes.
And peace abundant. Receive what you need from your Father this morning. Oh, it pleases Him to daily load you with benefits. It pleases Him to do good to His children. Oh, believe and receive what the Father has for you this morning. Thank you, Father. Thank you. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Oh, thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We just thank you, Father. Yes, Jesus. You are holy. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Every obstacle has already been overcome. Every obstacle.
Yes, Jesus.
Already overcome by our Lord Jesus. So we can, like Richard said, freely receive whatever He's already provided. Strength, peace, supply, abundance of life, healing,
yes.
Deliverance, redemption,
yes.
Freedom from every bondage is already provided. Oh, thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. So we come and we freely receive, Father, of your great benefits. And we thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. We thank you. Hallelujah. 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 And we say together, amen. Amen. Good all the time.
All the time.
Bless you, open door. You are blessed and favored. Pastor already sent out a text this morning that he's been praying for us in our service. Doesn't matter where they are, their heart's always here. Just know that. All right. We have some. Okay, come on now. There we go. All right, here we go. Our stewardship report so far for this month of August, $6,220.59. Praise God. We agree together that our needs are met, the needs of the house and your needs too. Our God is more than enough to meet every need. Amen. All right. Please make sure you mark your calendars, upcoming events. Saturday, August the 29th, there's a meeting with all the teachers at 6 p.m. Sunday, August the 30th, is the meeting after service with maintenance. And Sunday, August the 30th, is a meeting with the ushers and the greeters at 7 p.m. August is our training month for all workers. So please, if you are interested, if you already serve in that area, or if you're interested in serving, come. Amen. We're going to be adding to some classes for our young people. We're going to have to add another class on Wednesday nights. So, you know, you have a rich supply in you. Freely you've received, now freely give of your time and your talents. Amen. All right. Our Feed the Hungry dates are Friday, October the 9th, and Friday, December the 4th. If you possibly can, take some time. Go ahead and put in to take a little time off work. And come out to be a blessing in the community. All right. Work weekend will be Friday, October the 23rd, Saturday, October the 24th, as we prepare for our fall conference. We appreciate all the help. The more that come out, the quicker we get it done. We do all the little extra things that day. Praise God. All right. Fall conference for 2015 will be Saturday, October 31st, through Monday, November the 2nd. Go ahead and make your plans to be here. And be praying. Be praying for conference, because we believe that every year that it's the best we've ever had. And we've had some mighty good conferences. And we want to be praying that God will bring the folks that need to come and be refreshed and restored, and God will move mightily in this place to His glory. Amen. Focus family this week is Mr. Sammy Funderburk. Brother Sammy, We appreciate him. He is always working behind the scenes. And we just appreciate his heart for this place, for Open Door. So remember him specifically in your prayers this week. Now, if you don't know, Pastor and Teresa are on the vacation that we sent them on. Praise God. Maybe the first time that I remember that they've both gone together. They've taken vacations, but usually not together. So we're just excited to be able to bless them and help them to have some time. People need that. All right? Stand up with me. We want to declare what God has says we are. Amen? We're a family church, a Bible training center. We're changing Lancaster, South Carolina, and we're excited about Jesus. Amen. Oh, hallelujah. Our vision is Jesus Christ. Our mission is to preach, teach, and exalt the Lord Jesus Christ in all the fullness of His glory and power, and to radiate His love to our community and to all the world. Amen. Amen. Oh, we appreciate all that the Lord's got in store. We know our latter days are better than our former. And we expect great things. Hallelujah. Now, if you would, take your tithes, your offerings, and your alms in your hand. We know that the tithe belongs to the house, according to the Word of God. Our offerings are seed that we sow and we expect a great harvest from. And our alms are to help those in need. All right, so you ready? Father, we thank You for Your supply. We thank You that You give seed to the sower. We thank You that You not only give the seed, but You multiply the seed. We thank You for Your abundant supply. We thank You for increasing us, for increasing our outreach, and for taking what is given and multiplying it. Just as You did the loaves and the fish, we thank You that it's more than enough and that every family and every household is blessed abundantly. As they sow and give, we give You glory. We sow with cheerful hearts, thankful, excited to give and to sow into the things of God. So we commit this to You, and we give You all honor in Jesus' name. As you bring your tithes, your offerings, and your alms, take time to love on somebody.
Jesus is alive. Now surely we can all be changed, 'cause Jesus is alive. And everybody here can know Jesus is alive. Well, I will live through all my days to raise the banner of truth and light, and I sing about my Savior's love. And the best thing that happened was the day I met You. About my Savior's love and the best.
There's a song I want to do right now that reminds me of my grandmother, and you've heard me tell my story how she prayed me through. When I got saved.
All right. We could fellowship all day. But we don't want to miss the good word that God's brought with Brother Thomas. We appreciate the Sloans so much being with us and sowing into us and blessing us with the praise and worship. We're just so thankful for them. You know, they are part of us, whether they're here or not. When they're not here, they're out ministering. Praise God. We are loving folks, I tell you. That's a good thing. Praise God. Well, we just thank the Lord for his gift in Brother Thomas. We appreciate him coming and being willing to minister. He did a pretty good job already, didn't he? Kind of got us fired up already. All right, brother. I'm going to give it to you.
You may be seated. Yes, go, children, young people. You are blessed and highly favored of the Lord. Go learn. Learn something. Yeah. Learn something about Jesus. Praise God. Well, I tell you what, I just studied everything in the Bible yesterday, so that's not true. That's not quite true. I did go a lot of places, though. You know, when you get in there and you get to searching out things, you just go from you go here and you read this, and then you go on over here and you read this, and you just got to go on. And I found myself way beyond anything I could do today. So. Anyhow, it's all good. It's all good. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to 1 Chronicles. First Chronicles, the 28th chapter, the second verse we'll start with. Say amen when you get there. Okay, you got one on this side and three on that. Praise God. You know, God is so good to us. So good. Just standing up there, you know, all these things are running through my spirit while I'm up there praising the Lord and worshiping Him, and how blessed we are. We went to see Simeon. It was last week, wasn't it? And he's doing good, just learning and learning some things to do and some things not to do. You know, we all do that from time to time. Too often we have to learn what not to do more than what to do, you know, in situations. But he's blessed, and that my mind just was, I was up there worshiping today, and my mind went back a few years back, and this has nothing to do with where I'm going that I know of now, but I couldn't help but think back to when, you know, and those of you you guys weren't here when my son was here, but he had some neurologist called it seizure. Some called it something else. Didn't know what it was. Never did find out what it was. Come on, somebody. Never did find out what it was, because it quit before they got to it. After about a year of torture and torment and falling in the arms of Jesus more times than I can count. Just saying, I need you, Lord. come up here and wasn't a bit more able to do what I needed to do. Didn't feel like I was able to, but I probably was more able to praise and worship in that time than any time in my life, because I had to totally trust in Him. I had to totally believe in Him. And you know, I just thank God for where He's brought us from. Some of you know what I'm talking about, because you've been brought a long way. But here's what I'm really thankful for. I'm thankful I'm not where I'm going yet. Amen. There is more to know, more to learn, and more to see. And we haven't seen it all here. We've heard a lot. We've heard a lot here. We've heard as much here as any church on the face of this earth, I would dare say. And it's been good things. But God's not finished with us yet. He wants to take us another level, another step, another a new direction, maybe. I don't know. What label to put on it. I don't even like labels. I just know that God's got good things for His children. And I'm ready for them. Turn with me to 1 Chronicles 28 and 2nd verse there. You're there now, right? Then David the king stood up upon his feet and said, "Hear me, my brethren and my people. As for me, I had in my heart to build an house of rest for the ark of the covenant of the Lord, for the footstool of our God, and had made ready for the building. But God said unto me, Thou shalt not build an house for my name, because thou hast been a man of war and hast shed blood." You know, sometimes we get right on the edge of where we think we're going, and it seems like the rug gets pulled out from under us. Oh, y'all ain't never been there. It seems like sometimes, you know, you're going in a direction, and then all of a sudden you have no direction to go in. David was a man, the Bible says that David was a man after God's heart. He was seeking God. But David was a man of war, and he fought many great battles and shed a lot of blood. And so David had it in his heart. You see, somebody said one time, the road to hell is paved with good intentions. Yeah. You know, sometimes we have good intentions in our thought process, and then what we have in our heart to do, but it's not what God wants. So we have to back up and say, okay, wait a minute. I want what He wants. And that's what Brother Richard was talking about this morning. When we get to the point to where what He wants matters more than what we want, we know we're getting somewhere. We know we're headed in the right direction, because He has to be first and foremost in our lives. You know, I love church. I love the ministry. And I love my family. And I used to think that ministry was it. You know, I was a single guy. You know, and I know preachers that are this way right now today. And I've seen some of the problems it's created in their family. I finally learned one day that as I grew, became engaged, there's that word again, and as I grew in relationship with Sheila, and we got married and we started having kids, and that's the order of God. Amen? That's the order of God. That's the way God planned it to be. Find you a mate, a woman, if you're a man, and a man, if you're a woman, and get married, and have children after marriage. The world's got it all screwed up, but that's all right. We're going to see salvation come to the land anyhow, in spite of the thought process. So, well, I'm getting off track now. Mariah's talking about one of her professors that chases rabbits. I'm a good rabbit chaser. You could call me Beagle. David loved God. He had the right intention. He had the right heart. But God said, no, you're a man of war. David, he actually got mad at God. Got really upset with God because he stopped him from doing what was a good thing. He had built his house, and now he's going to build God a house, a place for the Ark of the Covenant to rest. That represented the presence of God. Nobody can contain God. Can I tell you that? Nobody can contain. We can't contain God in this nice place that God has made for us to, or allowed us to build for us to come and worship together. He can't be contained in these walls. He's bigger than that. Look at your neighbor and say, he's bigger than that. Bigger than that. But David had a good heart. But David couldn't build the house. Let me just say, in this season that we're in right now, just maybe God's not looking for a warrior. But he's looking for a builder. I'll let you think on that a while. I know that's a different kind of concept or mindset, but maybe God's just not wanting bloodshed right now. Maybe he doesn't want somebody to, we know how to kill people. We know how to shoot the wounded. Maybe we need to build a place of refuge for them. We're talking about all these people that have messed up and doing it the wrong way. We see them doing it the wrong way because we know the Word, but they don't know the Word. Some of them do. Go ahead and rebel against the Word. But maybe they need a place of refuge too. Maybe we don't need to shoot them and tell God to take them to heaven or wherever He's going to take them. Maybe we just need to build a place of refuge. You know, I'm not saying that this is the way it is and there's no other way. I know that some people are just made to be a warrior and they can't do it. You know, some soldiers, we had a guy that was killed in front of a church because he came back from being a soldier and he didn't know how to do anything else. So he gets a gun, goes to stand in front of the church. I don't know what was in his mind. Nobody does. He didn't tell nobody. And now today he's dead. You know, we got a lot of soldiers, a lot of good men that all they know is fighting because that's what they've been trained to do. They go into the military and I've been there. I went through those training sessions where they beat you down and make you feel like you're nothing. And that's exactly what they want you to feel like, right? Am I right? They want you to feel like you're nothing so that they can build you into the person they want you to be. Yeah. And they want you to be a warrior. Everything they train you to do is to train you to kill somebody. You see, I knew some stuff. Now, I've forgotten more than I remember. But I knew some stuff, but all of it, I couldn't use it in a fight. Because I was trained to kill. I wasn't trained to hurt. You know, the soldiers are trained to... No. You've got this uniform on. You're not trained to hurt somebody. You're trained to kill somebody. To shed some blood. To put a bullet in them. And that's what David had gone through. You see, he started this training when he was a kid. He started this training when he was a kid, when he's out there protecting those sheep, and all of a sudden, a lion comes out. He don't hurt him. He destroys him. You see, we've got this mindset in the church that we, you know, things that we've learned, we've learned some things and oh, send them to hell. They're going to hell in a handbasket. You know, we got this concept. And I want to tell you right now, it's harder for people to go to hell than we've made out for it to be. You know, preachers got up and want to send everybody to hell. Oh, you going to hell if you do this. And you going to, I've heard it. I've heard it over and over. I'm sitting in a church and I had on my high school ring. I was so proud to have graduated from high school. You don't know what a feat that was for me. I didn't care a thing about school. My daughter is an A student. She's straight A student. But I was not. Okay. So I was proud to have a ring on my finger that signified my diploma and graduating. I'm sitting in this church, sitting there all happy, and this evangelist comes back to me right at my pew, just like I was, Sister Edna was sitting there, that was me, and he was standing there and said, "You're going to go to hell for wearing those rings." See, I'm telling you now, I've been raised in this thing, and I grew up in some crazy ideas. Some of y'all, the way you're laughing, y'all know exactly what I'm talking about. Some of you can't believe that's going on, but let me tell you, it's still going on in churches today. We want to kill them and send them to hell more than we want to get them saved. Maybe God's trying to change our mindset that we're not to kill, but we're to build. Maybe we need to build up somebody instead of putting them down and say, "You're going to hell for everything you do it." Maybe we need to build them up and say, "There's a way that seemeth right unto man, but there's a God that has mercy and grace, and there is a Savior who died on the cross for our sins so that we can be saved." Build somebody up. Just go up to them and say, "Hey, man, I love you, and I'm praying for you." Instead of kicking them when they're down. They know they're beat up and broke and bent, and they know they are. We don't have, I got a nephew that's a drug addict. He's an alcoholic, been in jail more than he's been out. Do I go tell him he's going to hell? He knows he's going to hell. I need to tell him there's a way out for him. I need to tell him there's hope for him. Boy, I'm stuck up right here, but this is all right. We need to help somebody instead of beating them up. And oh, Jim here, he's a karate guy. Well, I don't know if he's a karate guy or not, but he's a karate guy. I got the nod from, and you know, he knows how to hurt people. But I see Jim. He's sitting there with his hands raised unto the Lord. Jim, there was something going on between you and God today. I don't know what was going on, but I looked back there and I saw it happening, and I like it. Because see, it makes him not want to go out here and hurt everybody. You know? God's presence does something for us. It changes our heart and our mind so that we don't want to beat everybody up and we don't want to hurt everybody. We want to love on somebody and let the love of Jesus flow through us. And see, I like it when I see people like Jim. I know where he come from. I know what he's been through a little bit. And I know where God's taking him. I don't know everything about it, but I see God doing something. And I say, keep doing it, Lord. Keep doing it, Lord. And I see some of you melting in the presence of God. And I see some of you, all it takes is, you know, just throw up a hand every once in a while. And I say, God's doing something right there. I'm glad about that. You know, because anytime you can get in the presence of God, He starts changing. He melts that hardness in the heart. And it's just His presence. Your presence is heaven to me. Oh, y'all had your chance to worship now. We're going to preach now. Oh, turn over to 2 Corinthians 10th chapter, 3rd verse. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. See, He wants you to break some strongholds over people's lives with your prayers and with your love. To break some strongholds, to change some thought processes. That's what a stronghold is. Mighty. Pulling down of strongholds. Casting down, the 5th verse, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalted itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. You see, if you can allow this to happen in you, and one of the best ways I know of, because I'm a worshiper, you see, I worship. I know the Word of God. I study the Word, but when I get in His presence, my mindset changes. I don't worry about lawsuits. I don't worry about money situations. When I get in His presence, my mind is just refreshed. My spirit is renewed. There's fresh oil, Pastor said last night. Said, let the Spirit be fresh in the house. Let the fresh oil be poured on the people. See, He knows some of you better than I do. He knows what you need, and He knows that God can do it for you. We think about these stronghold situations. Sometimes we think of it as a city or a nation. Oh, that city or that nation's got a stronghold over it. That's why Russia acts the way it does, or that's why China acts the way it does, or that's why the United States, or that's why San Francisco. Boy, we like to talk about the stronghold in San Francisco. But sometimes we just need to bring it down to right here. You see, sometimes we have strongholds in our thinking and in our mindset that we need broken. And the best way to get that broken is be full of the Spirit of God. Amen. Second Corinthians 10:5, casting down. Just read it. Casting down imaginations. We need to cast them down. We need to throw them aside, and every high thing that exalted itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity. Sometimes you just got to get a hold of your thoughts. One fellow said, you say, well, what about these thoughts that come? You know, everybody has thoughts. Okay? Are we okay there? Everybody has thoughts. Everybody has bad thoughts. I'm saved, sanctified, filled with the Holy Ghost, and on my way to heaven, I walk right, spit white, and I know all those things. And that's all they are, is things. You know, that's all they are. But sometimes we have to capture our thoughts. I started to tell you, one fellow said, well, when you get a thought, it's kind of like a bird landing on your head. You know, you shoo it away. Don't let it build a nest. Amen. You understand? Don't let it stay there. Think, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things. You know, get your mind right. Get your attitude straight. And let me move on. What are strongholds? Imaginations and high things that exalt themselves against the knowledge of God. And we all deal with those things. We just have to bring them under subjection to the Word of God and the Spirit of the Lord. Amen? And they're broken. But if they're not broken in your life, they need to be broken. Because sometimes strongholds can hinder so powerfully or greatly in your life that if we don't allow them to be broken by the Spirit of God and by the power of God, that those strongholds will keep us from doing what God wants us to do in the kingdom of God now. Building. Back to that. Building. Hey, sometimes you have a thought process that you think everybody hates you and you think everybody's against you, so you don't want to witness to nobody. And that's just a thought process because it's not the truth. You know, I've looked at people and I thought, man, them people are mean looking. But then if you get to know that person, like a big old teddy bear, you know, couldn't ask for a nicer person. See, those mindsets get in there, and if we don't deal with them and change our thought processing to Jude 1:20 says, but ye beloved, building yourselves up on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. That's how you do it. You want to be built up? Pray in the Holy Ghost. See, that word, that word there, praying in the Holy Ghost, that is to be beloved, building yourselves. To pray in the Holy Ghost is to allow Him to build something in you. Amen? It's very important that we as Christians allow the Holy Spirit to flow in us. See, in this day, I know of what I'm speaking of because I'm a preacher. And I pray in tongues a lot. But sometimes I get caught up in things and doing and I don't have time to pray in the Holy Ghost. Sometimes I can get caught up in studying the Word. That I don't allow the Holy Ghost to flow through me and pray through me. You see, that is our secret weapon. That's the Christian's secret weapon. If we would pray in the Holy Ghost, and you say, well, I don't even have the Holy Ghost. Well, all you got to do is receive it. It's a gift of God. And there again, preachers have made it hard. Oh, you got to go through this and you got to do this. No, you don't. All you got to do is receive. Because He said, if I go away, I'm going to send you a comforter. It's a gift. It's a gift that He sent and gave to us so that we could be the edifice There's a big word for you. We could be the edifice. We could be that building that God makes. You see, and I'm not that building altogether. Pastor John says, we don't have it all together, but together we have it all. And that's true in a lot of different areas. And right today, what I'm trying to bring forth to you, God wants to build some builders. But He wants to build in some builders. He wants to build His edifice. You got a part of it. You got a part of it. You got a part of it. And together, let me see if I can find that. Let me read this for you. 1 Corinthians 14:4 says, "He that speaketh in an unknown tongue edifieth." Edifieth. And that word there is to self. Speaketh himself. When you allow that Holy Ghost to pray through you, then you're being built up. And when you're built up, I said, we are lively stones, but we're on the foundation of the cornerstone. And Jesus is the cornerstone. See, when we're built on Him, when everything we do and we know and we see and we think, it begins to rotate around, or begins to be built. I can't use the word rotate because it doesn't go along with what I'm trying to say here. Everything we focus on is built upon a structure of Jesus. He's the cornerstone, the chief cornerstone. Now, I don't know a lot about construction, but from what I understand, there has to be a chief cornerstone in order for a building to begin to have a foundation. And let me tell you this. This church will only grow as big as its foundation. You see, this house, this building has a foundation. Now, you can tear down walls and you can extend this building, but first, you got to extend the foundation. Oh, come on, somebody. Help me. You can't do anything without a foundation. In other words, we can't do anything without Jesus. And whatever the ministry that we try to do has to be founded on Jesus. On Christ, the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. He is my chief cornerstone. And He does want to build something, but He wants to build it in you. And when He builds in you, when He builds something in you, then, oh my Lord, then you can go out and say, I know how this is done because the chief cornerstone is my foundation. And not to bring glory to your flesh, to bring glory to His kingdom. We're about building the kingdom of God. Amen? Let me finish this. Now therefore, you are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and of the household of God, and are built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ Himself being the chief cornerstone, in whom all the building fitly framed together groweth unto a holy temple in the land, in whom ye also are builded together. For what? For an habitation. Habitation of God. How? Through the Spirit. You see, in the modern day church, I don't want to put the modern day church down, but because we didn't have it right before the modern day church came. So I can't say nothing about the modern day church, because before the modern day church came, we didn't get it right. So, but the modern day church, they don't want you to talk about the Spirit of God, much less talk about in tongues about the Spirit of God. You know, and it's not just the Baptist church. I'm talking about so-called Pentecostal churches. You know, we're pushing the Spirit of and the move of the Spirit of God out of our church. And why do we think the government's doing what it's doing? Because we're not doing what we're supposed to be doing. We're not being Christians and being full of the Spirit of God. If you walk in the Spirit, you won't fulfill the lust of the flesh. The Bible says it's plain as day. You know, you say, well, I'm not about doing and not doing. Well, yes, you are. Are you're not founded on Christ. You know, it's not about our works. Our salvation is not about our work. I'm not even going there. I'm not even talking about that. But we do things every day of our life. And those things, if they are founded on the rock Christ Jesus, they will edify and they will build up the kingdom of God. Unless we do that, the edifice will not grow. The kingdom, the church, the ecclesia of God, well, it doesn't grow unless we build it. We are the builders. We're not called to be warriors. We're called to be builders. We're called to build the kingdom of God. And how do we do that? What's one of the best ways to do that? Is to be full of the Spirit of God. Full of the Holy Ghost. I want this church to be so full of the Holy Spirit that when you walk out of here, you're so wet with the Spirit of God that whatever dry person you come in contact with, it's just going to rub off on them. You say, well, how can that? Hey, I've seen it happen. You go into a situation and the Spirit of God is so in you and so prevalent in you that you don't even have to say a thing. You just be there and let God be God. It's not about you doing something all the time. You just be. That's what the Lord spoke to me several years ago. He said, just be. And I said, what is being? How do I be? I want to do something to be. I want to, can I pray more and be? And he said, no. He said, just be. Be who I called you to be. Be who I said you were in my word. Be who... Glory to God. So I've been trying to be. Well, that's hard. That's harder than you think it is. Just be. Just let it. Let it be. Let it be. It's hard to be sometimes. When you're a doer, you want to do something. You walk into a situation, I know what to do here. No, just let it be. Just you be and let it be. No, y'all don't know me. I'm a fixer. Oh, shout it loud, sister. Amen. My wife's over here saying, yes, Lord. She brings me a broke washing machine. I don't know a thing about a washing machine, but I'm going to fix it. And I did fix it too, didn't I? I'm a fixer. I like to figure it out. Get in there. I don't know what this part is. I don't know what it does. But it's broke. I'm going to fix it. And y'all don't know the struggle I have with being. You ought to know because you have the same struggle. You know, we're builders. We want to get out here and with our saw and our hammer and our nails, and we want to build. Yeah, we're going to build a kingdom. No, no, you ain't. Lest the Lord build the house, you labor in vain. Yeah, but. No, there ain't no yeah, but. Is this too real? Is this too simple? This is so simple, but we just float over it. Just be full of the Holy Ghost, everyone in this house. Just be filled with the Holy Ghost. And let Him build in you. Let Him edify you. Talk in tongues daily. Come on, saints. Talk in the Holy Ghost. You got a gift from God. Let that gift flow through you. And edify you. Build you up in your most holy faith. Build you up. And as you allow God to build you up, you may be something you didn't even think you could be. I preached about seed a while back. You know, a seed don't look like what it's going to be. Some of you are just seedlings. You're just a little seedling in God. And God wants to build you up into whatever He wants to build you up. I'm not going to name it. I don't like labels. Oh, the prophet's here. Oh, well, okay. So what? No. I don't mean any disrespect. I just don't like labels. Pastor John. Yeah, he's Pastor John. I love him. Full of the Word. Mighty man of God. Yeah. Pastor's just a label. Now, I respect the man and the gift of God in him. And I receive the Word of God that he speaks in the house. But it's not because of some label. It's because I have a relationship. You know? I'm through. I'm quitting. I'm done. Be full of the Holy Ghost. I bless you in the name of Jesus. To walk in and talk in tongues. To walk in the Spirit. To live life to the fullest, to be full of God's power and authority, and be who God says you are, not what the world calls you to be. You're not what the world says you are. Let me tell you right now, you're not what the world says you are, but you're who God says you are. You are blessed and highly favored of the Lord. You're to walk in His presence, to walk in His love, to fulfill His purpose in this earth. And to rule and reign as children of the Most High God, kings and priests, anointed of the Lord. Amen. If anybody needs prayer, we'll pray. I love praying for people. I love to lay hands on people. If you want prayer, I'll be here for you. If you don't have the Holy Ghost, praise God. God will fill you today. Amen. He will. Yes, He will. Praise God. Stand with us. Thank you, Lord, for your word. Thank you for your anointing. God, I love you. I love you. I love you. I love you. I love your children. I love your people. Lord, bless your people. You have blessed us and continue to bless us. Let us recognize the blessing of the Lord that is upon us and walk and cherish that anointing and that love that we have. Not to put others down, but to lift others up, Lord God. To build good things upon this earth. Good people. To build your kingdom purpose. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven, in Jesus' name. We love you, Lord. We praise you in Jesus' name. God bless you. God bless you. Amen. Anybody want prayer? I'm here.